Many of us believers often say that we believe that God can do anything. And I think when we say that, we sincerely mean it. And we sincerely believe it. But at the same time, when we say God can do anything, and we're looking at our own lives, and looking at God's will and purpose for our lives, we nonetheless put up fences and build borders around God and put God in a box and limit him. What do I mean by that? Where am I getting at? What am I driving at with this? Well, I think that our culture, not only our secular culture, but our religious culture, whatever sect or denomination of Christendom or Messianic Judaism that we come from, I think that shapes our perception of how God works. I recall and think of many times in my life when I'm exploring God's will and God's way and God's purpose for my life and what he wants. And I make presuppositions and assumptions on what his will is by the pattern of my either culture, in this case, Western culture, or by the culture that is found in my religious circles, my circle of faith, whether it be Protestant Christianity or Messianic Judaism. We put God in a box, and we think in traditional terms and traditional means. You know, if you're a Pentecostal, you think automatically of the government of the fivefold ministries and the gifts of the Spirit. You know, if you are from a non-Pentecostal charismatic sect of Christendom, you think of the pastor being the top rung on the ladder, and you think of pastors and deacons and things of this nature. And then if you're messianic, you know, you kind of think the same thing as a rabbi and a chazan and so on and so forth down the line. And you think of traditional means of ministry, traditional means such as, Protestant Christendom, you think of pastoring a church, or you think of a radio ministry, or you think of a missionary going to another country and setting up congregations and churches. If you are Messianic, you think of a rabbi of a congregation, or you think of, you know, a rabbi that starts a yeshiva or starts a school. And you're limited by the traditions and the thinking and the way things are governed and set up, man-made, albeit, within these sects and denominations. And we don't think outside the box. Therefore, we put God in a box and expect him to operate on those same parameters. And as I get older, as I get older and as I grow in my faith, I mean, I've spent 45 years on this planet, and, you know, in my short life, the older I get, the more I see God working in non-traditional ways, in ways that I didn't expect, ways that are not dictated by the Western culture or by the sector denomination that I'm a part of or running with at that time. And I think it's just amazing what God does. And, you know, every time I say never to God or no, he proves me wrong and makes me eat my own words, makes me eat crow and humble pie. Every time I think, okay, I know God has called me to do X, Y, and Z, therefore, the only way to fulfill that is A, B, C. It's not always the case. You know, I may know what God's giftings are to me and his calling upon my life, but I don't always know how he wants me to fulfill it. Here recently, God has just surprised me and shocked me in ways of fulfilling the calling on my life. I'm using my gifts and talents and callings in ways that I never dreamed of or imagined, or in non-traditional ways that even border on what some may consider secular means or secular ways, in order to fulfill a prophecy, or not a prophecy, in order to fulfill a calling on my life. And I just think it's awesome. And it's strange because I feel so backward and feel so much like a hypocrite in the sense that when I grew up, I was a nonconformist and I was bucking against the system and I was thinking of new and innovative ways to minister and to reach out to other people and was often criticized by the traditional religious establishment of the day back then. And now that I'm older, I'm finding that, you know, in that expansive mindset that I have or had back when I was younger, I'm being set in that way. And yet there's still even more beyond what I thought of when I was younger. There's more beyond, there's more out there. There's more that God could do even by my limited ideals that I had when and espoused when I was younger. So I'm having to continue to learn to be flexible and to expand my mind and my imagination in regards to what God can do. So let's not limit God. Let's not put God in a box. Let's not limit him. Go out there and you know, like he told the prophets to do shocking things that were non-conformist, non-traditional. He told Isaiah to do, I think it was Isaiah, to do really weird things, or maybe it was Ezekiel. I might be getting my prophets mixed up, but told him to lay on one side for so many days and to build a model of Jerusalem and have it besieged for so many days. And he told Ezekiel to only eat this certain kind of bread and just weird and odd kind of things. He even told the prophet Hosea to marry a temple prostitute or one that was formerly a temple prostitute. It's totally unheard of and seemingly totally bizarre. Like, you know, where did that come from? And so that these prophets were criticized by the religious establishment and the culture and the people of that day because God was telling them to do weird things. He told one prophet to walk around without any clothes on for a certain amount of time or walk around in a loincloth, which was basically considered being naked back in the day, to dig and tunnel through a wall and pack his stuff out with him while doing that and as an example and just weird and odd things. And yet, we forget about those passages conveniently when it comes to our own secular and or religious culture. And when somebody steps outside the norm and does something radical, does something unexpected or unheard of or innovative, we often criticize them and thinking, oh, well, God couldn't have spoken to them. Be careful. You know, we can say things against God. We can say things against Yeshua. But the scripture says that we can't say things against the Holy Spirit and expect to be forgiven. We can't blaspheme the Holy Spirit and attribute something that God told somebody to do and say, oh, that's not of the Lord, that's of the devil. We got to be careful, you know? So we can't be quick to be judgmental or quick to get on a bandwagon against somebody just because they're doing something different. I even think of the disciples of Yeshua, where they saw a man that wasn't hanging around them, wasn't a part of their group, and yet he was casting out demons in Yeshua's name and preaching the same things that Yeshua is preaching. And the disciple says, hey, we ran into this guy, and this is what he's doing. We told him to stop because he doesn't hang with us. And Yeshua's like, why in the heck did you tell him to do that? You know, somebody who is speaking for me can't be against me. Leave the guy alone. Let him do his thing. You know, so we need to think and believe outside the box. The guidelines that we have are the Torah, you know, and obviously if it contradicts the Torah or goes against the Torah, you know, then it's not of God and we shouldn't do it. But, you know, there's a lot of gray areas ministry-wise when it comes to the scripture and innovatively reaching out and ministering to others or fulfilling a specific calling that you have on your life based on the gifts and talents that God has given you. So don't be afraid to dream. Don't be afraid to try new things. And you know, don't be surprised if the Lord approaches you one day and tells you to do something totally weird, totally off the wall, totally unorthodox, totally flying in the face of the secular and or religious culture of your day and time and place in the world. You know, I remember what it says in the prophetic scriptures that God is doing a new thing. He's not stagnant. He's a living God. He's not a dead God. He's not stagnant. He's a living God. And therefore living means he's always active. He's always moving. And he realizes that, you know, with each successive generation, there comes stagnancy, there comes desensitization among the people. And God is using new ways, new mediums, new outlets in order to reach and minister and touch people. And we need to be in flow and in sync and in movement with the Spirit of God in these areas. So take those things into consideration, and don't be afraid, you know, when God approaches you and say, Lord, is that really you? It's okay to say, send me confirmation, because you may think, wow, maybe this is just a weird cockamamie idea out of my head. I want to make sure this is of God, because I don't want to birth an Ishmael, right? I don't want to do something that I think is God's will and is really not. And that's okay to ask for confirmation. But when that confirmation comes, don't be afraid to jump on that horse and ride. You know, as they say in the South, that dog will hunt or that'll preach. So don't be afraid to do those things. Guys, thanks so much for listening to my ramblings and just to the thoughts that are bouncing around my head. This has been an edition of Ray Bash's Ramblings. Guys, thanks for listening. Shalom. Shavua Tov.
Thanks for watching. Don't forget to press the like button as well as the subscribe button if you haven't done so already, and the notification bell that'll let you know every time I make a new video. And don't forget to share this with a friend. Also, visit our website at abrahamsdescendants.com. Thanks. Shalom.